Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and a very warm welcome to John Hampden Grammar School's Question Time, JHGSQT. And I understand that tonight's been a sellout, which is absolutely wonderful. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Ruth Farwell. Until very recently, the Vice Chancellor at Buckinghamshire New University. I retired at the end of January of this year. Shortly, I'm going to introduce our panel, the parliamentary candidates for Wycombe, the Wycombe constituency, our local constituency. And I think it's going to be very interesting to hear what those candidates have to say to those who are going to be voting for the first time on the 7th of May this year. Over to our panel. I'm going to introduce them from your left through to the right. And we have Jem Bailey, who is the candidate for the Greens. He's a Flackwell Heath resident, and he stood in 2010 for Beaconsfield. Now he's the Wycombe Green Party fielding him as their candidate. So welcome, Jem. Next to him is Steve Baker, our sitting MP for Wycombe. He was elected in 2010 for the first time, and he's standing again this time round for the Conservative Party. Then moving over to immediately on my right as you're looking at the stage, David Meacock, who is the UKIP candidate. He's been a Chiltern District Councillor and is Wycombe born and is a musician. Then David Williams, QC, the Labour Party candidate, who is a barrister specialising in family law. And then finally, last but by no means least, Steve Guy, the Liberal Democratic candidate, selected again to represent that party. He's a local resident and a former Wycombe District Councillor. So let's welcome our panel. Or you've had the pleasure, the privilege of hearing the earlier debate from the students. And we want to bring some of the points that were made in that debate to hear what our parliamentary candidates have to say in relation to some of those issues that were raised. And our first question is going to come from Fatima Khan.
Hello, I'm Fatima Khan and I'm from Wycombe High School. My question is, should the voting age be lowered to 16 years old in the UK?
Who'd like to start off?
Should we leap in?
David, you stop.
The answer to that is absolutely yes. I've spent a lot of my professional life over the last few years working to try to get children's voices heard in legal proceedings concerning them. And the Supreme Court last year decided to change the law to give children and young people a greater voice in those proceedings. And there are two reasons why it's right that young people should have a say in important decisions. One is that as an autonomous individual, they have a right to be heard. But secondly, they can add value to the decision-making process, and I think what's right in that context is equally applicable in democracy. And certainly, my experience of working with young people, and I've worked with a lot of them over the last few years in court. Probably two of the most impressive individuals I've worked with have been a 13-year-old girl and a 16-year-old girl who I represented, and they were very mature, very insightful, and had a lot of value to add to that proceeding. So I think that 16-year-olds can do that to the democratic process, and they bring a lot of enthusiasm, energy, and ideas that we would benefit from.
And Jen, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, totally agree. When you look, all you have to do is really look at the Scottish referendum that went on. 75% of those actually registered to vote actually cast the vote. I mean, it's a huge phenomenon. I mean, it gives more representation and it gives more of an open democracy. You know, at 16, you can go and get a job, you pay your taxes, you can join the army, you can get married, you can have children. Why not vote? Now, we are standing a district councillor in every ward in High Wycombe. 60% of the people who were standing are under 25. So, you know, why not give you guys the vote?
Yeah, I think the fact you're asking the question shows that you are fit to exercise the vote because you're thinking about these questions and you're interested in them. I think there's a part of a broader debate about when people become ready to do all sorts of things. Drink alcohol, drive a car, join the armed forces, pay taxes, whatever. I'd rather have a conversation about when you become an adult and then make a range of things possible. But that's actually a very difficult conversation around certain very sensitive areas, like, for example, what kind of films you can act in. I don't want to say any more about that, but that's a problem. That's a problem that comes up at one particular party's conferences every now and then. But it's quite clear to me that there are plenty of 16-year-olds who are ready to vote and should be able to do so. I think we need to, and certainly can add value, but I would say to you, you add value anyway. Over the last 5 years, every young person I've met has added something to my understanding of their life, their prospects, their hopes and aspirations and dreams, and you have made a difference. The issue, I think, really is when do you stop? Because if we say 16, well, 15, 14, David mentioned somebody 13 who was obviously added something to his work and understanding. So I think there is a conversation to be had. I'm open to people being able to vote at 16, but I think it's so subjective about the individual, and it's tied into a whole range of other ages of consent, if you like. But am I warm to it? Yeah.
The other Steve.
Yes, that was the last thing I said, yeah.
I'll tell you something straight. Us candidates fear the hustings at the schools the most. Right? When we go to a hustings where it's all adults and an adult audience, we can more or less predict what most of the questions are going to be. When we go and do a school hustings and it's 16, 17-year-olds asking the questions, they're some of the most well thought out. They come at it from a different angle. And it just makes it very clear to me that as an age group, 16 or 17-year-olds really are thinking about issues. It's a point in your life where you're moving from the young world to the adult world, if you like. And people start looking at all those big questions, where do taxes come from? Where do MPs come from? Why do we do this way? Why is that the law? And you start looking at all of those questions at 16 and 17. And I think you're absolutely the right people to get involved in the democratic process, definitely.
And David?
Well, thank you for your question, Fatima. I think you've opened up a real can of worms here with this question, so congratulations for doing that. Marriage at 16, driving at 17. Where's the logic in that? In the USA, I heard from one of my pupils, because I teach the piano, in the USA you can drive when you're only 15, yet there you can only drink when you're 21, whereas here, of course, as soon as you hit 18, you can go and have a drink. Legally at home, you're allowed to have a drop of alcohol when you're 5. I think there's a wider question on the voting issue, and that is, why is it that those who can already vote don't bother? I mean, in local elections, we have the grandiose turnout of about 20%. The suffragettes fought for the right to vote, but so many women don't take that opportunity now. Even for the general election, the voting figures in the Wycombe constituency was only in the 60%. So I think your question opens up a huge range of questions, actually. And I must say I'm inclined towards saying, well, actually, let's try and get some logical uniformity in these ages and tackle them all together. But at the moment, it's not current UKIP policy to lower the age of voting.
So does that mean that you wouldn't support lowering the voting age to 16?
Well, I wouldn't want to just deal with that in isolation. I'd want to look at the whole range of when you can do all these things together. I think also, just because you can't vote doesn't necessarily mean you can't participate. You know, there is a role for everybody to play, and perhaps, as we all develop at different ages in our teens, you have some 16-year-olds who I'm sure we all know are 16 going on 6, and others who are 16 going on 26. There's a huge range of development at that age, and I'd actually rather deal with the whole issue together rather than just pulling one issue out on its own.
I'm not sure where you're coming from, Fatima. I guessed in asking the question that you support this. Have you got anything you'd like to add?
I don't think I would have been able to make that sound judgment. So in order for this to be okay, and in order for 16-year-olds being able to vote, I think government politics should be compulsory and it should be taught with passion and enthusiasm instead of just being one of those subjects where you were just forced to learn it.
May I say something? It's really interesting to hear you say that, Fatima. The first time I read any kind of book of politics was after I'd decided to seek election when I was probably about 38. So it's a really interesting observation. What I would say is now twice I've hosted a debate called Westminster to Wycombe, where we've set up a model of parliament at Highcrest. I can't remember if you were there for one of them.
I think I was.
Yeah, years 10 and 11 were absolutely brilliant. The sixth form were absolutely brilliant. The first time I ran it, I didn't allow interventions in debate because I thought it would be too much. It was a mistake. The second time we did it, we allowed interventions. And I've never seen anything quite so inspiring as young people debating real solid issues, war and peace, European Union, digital copyright, all the rest of it. Absolutely brilliant. The truth is, I think, if the individual is interested and has informed themselves, then they're ready to vote. But there'll be others maybe not so ready. It is a hard question, but I'm warm to it, not least because I've seen young people and how brilliant they can be in those debates.
Thank you very much for your question. Our next question is from a JHGS student, and that's George Wright.
Hello. My question is, considering the rise of UKIP and the Greens, have Labour abandoned traditional socialist values? Likewise, have the Conservatives forgotten traditional Conservative values, and has this contributed to a larger vote share for the more extreme parties?
Thank you very much for your question. So, I think, you know, very provocative. Have Labour abandoned their traditional socialist values? What about the Conservatives forgotten their traditional Conservative values? And has this contributed to a larger vote share for the more extreme parties? Well, let's ask David Williams as the Labour Party candidate, Labour was at the first part of your question.
Have we abandoned our traditional values, George? The answer is no. Do you want me to add? Do you want me to expand on that?
We did abandon the NHS.
The reason for that is that if you go back to the earliest days of the Labour Party, the Labour Representation Committee back in 1900, the reason why the Labour Party was formed was to represent ordinary people. And that theme has continued all the way through our existence, whether you look at 1945 and the election in 1945, fighting the five evil giants of squalor and health and ignorance and deprivation. And it continues as a thread running through the heart of Labour policy right up to the current day, because what Labour fundamentally is about is making life better for ordinary people, improving their lot through two things. One is practical help, practical policies to make their lives better, but secondly, and perhaps more fundamentally, is through the aspiration to create a fairer, more equal society where opportunity is in the hands of the many, not the few, and where we're trying to create a society which everybody has a stake in, which will develop into a stable, a healthy, a prosperous democracy. And at the core of all of that is people, putting people first, not putting the economy first, putting the economy where it belongs, which is as the servant of the people, a means to an end, which is to improve the lot of everybody here. And so that still remains as fundamental to the Labour Party as it ever has. That's one of the reasons why I've joined the Labour Party, and that's one of the reasons why I'm standing, because we want to make it better for ordinary people, and we want to create a fairer society. So, no, we've not abandoned it. Why have other parties started to eat into the what was historically the share of the vote that essentially the Conservatives and the Labour Party divided up between them? I think partly it's because there's a much greater awareness of issues. I mean, there's so much more information available, there's so much more interest in issues like green issues, for instance. And that attracts a lot of people. For them, the core, the thing of core importance for them is the environment, so their natural home may be the Green Party. For others, they're responding to fear, to the sort of the message peddled by UKIP, which is to prey on people's fears in a time of recession, and so people gravitate towards that in the way that they gravitated towards fascism or communism in the 1930s. And so yes, there are people who will gravitate towards single issue groups. Or to more extreme parties, but I think for me, Labour remains true to its roots because we are a party for the people.
I'm going to go to the other end of the question now, which was, I think, something I'm not making any judgment here about which parties are extreme, but I'm going to turn to the other David. And since you were kind of shaking your head quite vigorously with some of the things that we heard from David Williams. David Meacock.
Thank you very much. Well, thanks for your question, George. I would like just to question one part of it, in fact, correct it even, and that is you mentioned that the UKIP and Greens are extreme. I'm very happy sitting in the middle of the table here. It's symbolic of the fact that in UKIP we don't have left and right, we have right and wrong. Well, it's true. If you actually look at the makeup of UKIP, there are many people who have come from the Labour Party who do feel, to answer your question, that the current Labour Party, particularly the hierarchy, have abandoned the traditional Labour voter. There are many people, of course, who come from the Conservatives for a number of reasons, politically correctness being one of them, and feeling that the Conservative Party has become out of touch. It's just full of professional musicians, politicians, sorry, who've never done anything else in their life. So to answer your question directly, yes, I do think that the reason why people are turning to the Greens and UKIP is because they do feel that they've been forgotten. I mean, the Liberal Democrats made a promise not to increase tuition fees, in fact, to cut them. And we've seen a threefold increase in those. Labour, they ruined the pensions. They decreased GP provision in their last administration. Who would have thought the Labour Party of all parties would have done those things? So, and of course, they certainly didn't put the economy first. Racking up £700 billion worth of debt, which the current coalition has taken only 5 years to double. So UKIP couldn't do any worse than that, could we?
I'm going to oscillate up and down the political spectrum here and ask Steve Guy to say something.
Thank you. I'm not quite sure how to take that. I mean, to go back to the original question, I don't think that it's for me to say whether Labour have strayed from their principles or whether Conservatives have strayed from their principles. That's not for me to say, that's for you to judge. Liberalism is a very old idea. Those of you that are studying politics will have probably heard of a guy called John Stuart Mill and his book on liberty, which we still refer to today when we're trying to make decisions on what our policies should be on certain issues. I think if you join a political party because you believe in that party's philosophy, each issue that arises, you have to apply your philosophy or beliefs to that issue. And in that sense, the parties are all going to evolve because we get greeted by new issues that we weren't facing 10, 20 years ago. Climate change is a very good example. So for the last 20 years especially, people have become more concerned about climate change and what we're going to do about climate change. And UKIP is the party that most of their members deny it's even happening. So, we look at the science. So 20 years ago, 30 years ago, this wasn't an issue. So we didn't have policies on it 50 years ago. We had to formulate the policies based on what we understand today. So in that sense, of course, we're changing. But we're still very much rooted in principle, and the principle of liberalism or liberty is that we want the rights of the individual to live their lives in liberty, to you to have as much freedom to live your life the way that you want to live it. And the role of government is just simply to protect your liberty and enable you to do that. And when it comes to the environment, we need to protect the environment and the climate for future generations so that your children can enjoy the environment in this planet. So governments should only be making rules that are to protect your freedoms and your liberty, basically. That's what we believe in. But we have to adapt to the changing situations.
I guess, Jim, that...
have they changed? I personally think that everyone else has gone a bit more right, and we've probably stayed where we are. We are predominantly the left wing, the only left wing party that's probably still up here. Extreme, I hate to think, are we extreme? Or are UKIP and us extreme? No, we've always had our values, and we have since we started in the 80s. It's a case of those values are more relevant, yes. I don't like the fact we're still classed as a one policy party. We're not. We're a grown-up party nowadays. We have policies to actually sit in government. It has shown with Caroline. Now, it's where, you know, it's where you sort of say it's how you stray, really. It's just fine to sort of a little bit demeaning on other people say. I mean, I'm not going to talk about sort of climate change and the science fact of it, 'cause we all know where that is in this room. But if people are stray, then that's not for me to say. That's the Labour and the Conservatives have gone away from their core values.
George, it's a beautiful question. Let me tell you, I like some old socialists. I really miss Jim Dobbin, who I served on the Transport Select Committee with. He died, I'm afraid. Kelvin Hopkins is a wonderful man. I saw him yesterday, in fact, and exchanged good views. I've made alliances with Michael Meachos on the proper left of the Labour Party. And the reason that I like these old socialists is that they've got a noble aim. Socialists have always aimed a rapid increase in the living standards of ordinary people. And that is a noble and laudable aim which I share. But the problem with socialism is it always chooses force as the means. It chooses power and politics. And what happens when you try to do something quickly using force? You break it. And what have they done this time? They've broken it, haven't they? They've dropped this country in the mess. They put Britannia on its knees, and we've had to lift her back up again. Now, what did socialism really stand for once upon a time? The public ownership of the means of production. Well, they abandoned the public ownership of the means of production, and it knocked the Conservative Party sideways. That sideways move created space for UKIP. Then we've ended up arguing over green issues, and there's been another space emerging. If you look now at what Rachel Reeves is saying, Reeves, according to The Guardian, said Labour did not want to be the party of the welfare state. She said, quote, "We are not the party of people on benefits. We don't want to be seen, and we're not the party to represent those who are out of work," she said. "Labour are a party of working people formed for and by working people." Do you know what? If you want a job, vote Conservative. Look at the jobs miracle we've put in place. It's amazing. Wickham, the unemployment wasn't that high. It was 3.8%. It's now down at 2%. The jobs miracle we've produced is enormous. So if you want to be a working person, vote Conservative, and we'll create the conditions where a job will be there for you. And I'll tell you what, if you are out of work, you vote Conservative, because I'll make sure there's a job there for you. Now, the other point is this. There are two parties that made this country great. The Liberal Party and the Conservative Party. A party to advance liberty and a party to urge caution. And once again, two parties over the last 5 years have come together in the national interest. They've held together for 5 years. And actually, I'd pay tribute to the Liberal Party, because they were prepared to do what was necessary to turn this country around, and that is what we are doing. Have socialists abandoned their original fundamental noble aim? No. Of course, they still aim at it. But they always choose the wrong means. It always goes wrong. And then the pragmatic, relatively anti-ideological Conservative Party has to sort it out afterwards. And I really don't want to go through any of that again. I hope that we get an outright Conservative majority, pragmatism, delivering for the people of Britain, and making sure that we don't end up with this mess again.
I should say that we do have some roving microphones in the audience. So if anybody in the audience would like to make something, some statement connected with what we've, what, anything we've just heard in relation to that question. We've got somebody there around the middle. Yep.
Hiya.
Can you say who you are before you ask the question?
Lucy Auger from Wycombe High School. I think that, as much as it pains me to say it, Labour have abandoned their traditional principles. I don't think the Conservatives are any better. They're just recycling. We've seen yesterday David Cameron's policy on freezing energy prices. They're recycling Labour policies. You can't tell the difference. I think people are voting Green because they see them as a socialist alternative, which Labour is unfortunately not anymore. I think they're committed to the economy over the people.
If David Cameron has promised to freeze energy prices, it's passed me by. I mean, we mocked Labour's promise to do it when energy prices started falling, and I'm not aware that we've pledged to do that, but I shall certainly look for that pledge as soon as I get to an internet connection.
I think there was another question towards the back.
The Labour and Tory candidates...
Could you say who you are, please?
John Green, a squash coach. The Labour and Tory candidates professed they were for the people. So the question really is, why did they both, 3 weeks ago, go through the lobby and vote for £30 billion worth of austerity, more austerity, when a very large percentage of the population is relying on food banks in this country? Well.
It is unacceptable that anybody needs a food bank. It is unacceptable. I haven't finished, David.
Your government's watch that this has happened, Steve.
It is unacceptable. And the way to get people out of that position is to get them into work and moving forwards. Now, there's at least four people involved with the food bank locally who've got my mobile number and welcome to call me anytime, and I'll give them whatever help they want. Now, I understand that only 6% of the people who use the food bank in Wycombe are chronically dependent on it. And there is something wrong for those families, and they need help, and they need somebody to get alongside them and walk with them and help sort out whatever the problem is that means that they end up needing chronically to go back to the food bank. And I want to do that, and I'm in touch with the One Can Trust, and if I'm re-elected, I will certainly be right alongside them doing whatever I can to help turn those families around. On the point of £30 billion,
I'm going to move us on, Steve. David Williams.
It's not just in Wycombe, is it, that there are food banks? I mean, across the South East, there are 90,000 families using food banks on a regular basis. I mean, this is the sort of poverty that Conservative austerity measures are going to take us back to, and the worst is yet to come. I mean, the Office for Budget Responsibility is telling us that in the next 2 to 3 years, the cuts are going to be even worse than anything we've experienced in the last 5 years. And things are cut to the bone already. So the idea that the Conservatives are going to assist people, ordinary working people, over the next 5 years is pie in the sky. Labour has a different plan. Labour does not plan on making the cuts that the Conservatives will. Labour plans on making sure that the burden of facing austerity is shared fairly by those who can, by looking at the corporations, by looking at the wealthy, by looking at the mansion tax, to ensure that we raise the funds that we need to minimise the impact of the measures that have to be taken to reduce the deficit. But we will do it fairly. The Conservatives will always, that's because they are a party of wealth and privilege, they will always cut taxes for the wealthy and the privileged. They will always allow the hedge funds and the banks the liberties that they have over the last 5 years, and it will come at the expense of ordinary people. I mean, that's pretty fundamental to the choice that faces the country on the 7th of May. Are we going to look to share the burdens of austerity fairly? Or are we going to carry on in the way that the Conservatives, and I blame the Conservatives more than the Lib Dems, are we going to carry on with the way that they have approached it, with really severe cuts, whilst still cutting taxes for those who are already privileged? That's a very simple choice.
Steve Guy.
Well, thank you. You've just heard there a very good illustration of what the Lib Dems are for. People are asking, what are the Lib Dems for? The problem's just been laid there, right in front of you, right now. Country's got a big debt. How do we pay it back? The Conservatives will cut everything to the bone, cut public services to the bone. The Labour Party will just go, oh, well, we'll just keep paying for everything because that's the way that we do things. And well, that's what you did for 12 years. That's why we were in the mess we're in.
No, we didn't. There was a world economic
recession. Well, okay, David, I didn't interrupt you.
Sorry.
So what I'm saying is that's the point of the Liberal Democrats. That's exactly what we've done in this coalition, is we've sought to balance the need to pay back the deficit and the need to protect the most vulnerable in our society. And where I do very much agree with Steve Baker is that the people I want to help first are the people who are working but on low incomes, which is why it was our policy in 2010 to increase the basic tax threshold to £10,000. And in the coalition, we've done that. So that people who are modest incomes are being taken out of tax and paying less tax.
Jen, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I think you've got to look at it, really. I mean, the divide between the rich and poor has never been so great, and that is under the Conservative government.
Inequality's narrowed.
It's never been so great. I mean, they say they've created jobs. Yes, they've created 2.5 million jobs in the private sector, but they tend to sort of forget about the 1 million that's been lost in that public sector as well. Look at the jobs they have created. A lot of those are zero-hour contracts. You know, one in three young workers are on low wages. It's predominantly is going on to that creating austerity. I mean, you've got to really look at the sort of getting after that tax avoidance. Tax avoidance, I mean, it costs this country £34 billion a year. Now, unless you go after the people, the rich percentage of this country, you're never going to solve the problem.
David Mitchell.
Well, thank you. I mean, first of all, I think it's a bit rich for David to talk about tax and all that sort of thing, and that corporations should be paying their tax, which they jolly well ought to be paying their tax, when only recently we've heard that Ed Miliband has accepted a tax, very tax-efficient donation, because apparently about half of it would have otherwise been paid to the taxman had that donation been given in cash rather than in shares. Perhaps David would like to tell us whether he thinks that actually the Labour Party should voluntarily pay that tax to pay for the sorts of things that he's advocating to help the less well-off in society. In spite of austerity, the economy has not been fixed. And once again, we hear about the deficit. Now, let's get this straight. The annual deficit is an annual negative of what you're spending, i.e. spending more than what you're getting in. The debt is what's piling up. And what's happened under this government, which came together, do you remember the love affair in the 10 Downing Street Rose Garden, putting differences aside to fix the economy? Well, the debt has doubled from 700 billion to 1.4 trillion. That's not fixing the economy. Spending has gone on white elephants like HS2. We throw billions into the EU, which will be better spent at home. We also give away billions on foreign aid to countries that can already afford their space program and their own nuclear defense. We need to cut out all of that sort of waste, and then we might have some chance, actually, of fixing the economy, and that's what UKIP are going to do.
I'm sure we will be circling around those kind of issues again as we go on to some of the other questions, but I'm going to go on to our third question. From Taj Syed, a Lower 6 student here at JHGS.
Hi. As young voters, many of whom will soon be facing enormous university fees, what will you do for us?
So, university fees.
The government's policy is where it is at the moment with fees where they are, and lots of help to pay them. Student loans which have an income level before which you don't pay anything back, and there's help for people who are less well off, and there's more students going to university than ever. But you know, here's the problem: prices for things you'd theoretically love to be set by supply and demand, but then you've got to make sure there's equitable access to higher education. So the result is you end up with a cap and help to pay for it. There's a danger, therefore, that prices don't find the right level. Now, when there was talk of the the fees coming down. I think it's fair to say the Vice-Chancellor's protested quite strongly. If we artificially suppressed the fees, then universities would suffer. You'd have fewer universities and they'd be less good. The real question here is about investment in yourself. What investment do you want to make in yourself to make sure that you, and as part of our country as a whole, are fully equipped for the future? I think that the policy as it is about right, because I think it incentivises people to think about how they're investing in themselves, and there is very considerable taxpayer support within that framework of incentives to make sure that people can go to university. So I think, although it'd be weighing very heavily on your minds, all of you, I think that the policy where it is about right.
Who else would like to come in on that? David Meacock then.
Well, thank you. UKIP's policy is that we should get rid of university tuition fees altogether. You laugh. I didn't have to pay any university tuition fees, certainly as an undergraduate. I did my master's degree part-time because it was cheaper to do it over 2 years than to do it full-time and allowed me to do other things alongside it. But the undergraduate degree was paid and there was a mean-tested cost of living grant that was given as well. And the problem that we've got is if you try to put in a one-size-fits-all 50% of everybody over 18 must go to university, you then have a huge number of people that the country can't afford. And I don't think everybody is cut out for university academia. A lot of people are better doing trades and apprenticeships, which again is what UKIP wants to encourage. So we get rid of this nonsensical 50% target of 18 plus, and then we can actually afford to educate those who are academically talented and have proved themselves at school and should be then being supported in that, because that's good for the country to have people with those sorts of skills. One of the objections I have to making students pay is that if they do a course at £9,000 a year fee plus then living expenses, they have this huge millstone of debt round their heads. And then how can any students then come back and live in Wycombe when house prices as a multiple of average salaries are at a historical all-time high? We've got the average house price in Wycombe is £356,000 rounded. Well, how can anybody get a mortgage for that if they've already got £50,000 or £100,000 worth of student debt that they are having to pay off once they exceed £21,000 a year? It's nonsensical. UKIP has the sensible policy here.
David Williams, what do you think about the balance of state and private funding going into universities?
Well, when I went to university, I didn't have to pay tuition fees, and I got a maintenance grant, and I seem to remember that there were some quite good universities around then, Steve, so I don't think that tuition fees have to be charged at £9,000 a year in order for us to have a good university system.
Or at six.
You all know that the Labour Party policy is to reduce the tuition fees to £6,000. And the reason for that is to ensure that education is accessible to all. I mean, Steve says that numbers aren't dropping, but the UCAS report, which came out only a few weeks ago, says that student numbers are 5% less than they would expect them to be on historical trends. And it's inevitable that the reason for that is that £9,000 tuition fees are putting people off. If you do a course in London and you have to pay the £9,000 and you take a maintenance grant as well, by the time you leave after 3 years, your debt's £53,000 and accumulating interest at 3% per year above inflation. If you then go on to do a vocational training course, if you go to a bar school or something like that, you've got another year's worth of tuition fees and another year's worth of maintenance. By the time some young people come out of education after 4 or 5 years, they've got a debt of £100,000 nearly hanging around their necks. And I don't think that's the right way for a young person to start off their life. So we want to reduce tuition fees. We want to make sure that young people get the best start in life, but also to access education. And we'll start doing that by reducing them from 9,000 to 6,000.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, I think the Green Party policy is like healthcare, really. Education should be free for the point of use. We also really support sort of mature learning that goes on. So, you know, it's actually the continued learning throughout your age, so, and supporting the mature students. So, I mean, you are looking at the end of actual your university, you can be in £50,000 of debt, as David said. It's really, you know, it's all about sort of bringing back sort of the lifelong learning system on this one. And how you pay for it, it's really where you choose to cut. You know, the Conservative government will cut different things than we decide to cut. We truly support something like the 10-to-1 Fair Play Campus campaign, which you've got people like vice chairman on £300,000 a year, where you've got cleaners on minimum wage, stuff like that. So it's bringing back that sort of bit of fairness really on the whole sort.
And Steve.
Thank you. I remember very well sitting on a podium like this in another grammar school 5 years ago, defending what I believe in, which is just I would ideally like university education to be free, like it was when I left school. I do also think that it's true that Labour's policy of getting 50% of young people to university has been misguided. I think one of the effects of that has been, yes, it's become too much money for the country to pay for everybody. But also another of the effects of that is that it's devalued degrees. So when I left school, if you had a university degree, it really meant something. It really set you apart in the workplace. And it meant that you were almost guaranteed to get a really good, well-paid job. It doesn't mean that anymore. And what I would say to you as sixth formers are looking at your future is, if you get a university education, it is going to cost you some money. You are going to have to pay it back. Is it the right thing for you? Is it a degree that you're doing that's going to help you to get the job that you want? Because there, you know, why be in a load of debt? And there are a lot of people out there in debt paying back for degrees that are not in the jobs that they studied for. And then one of the things that we've done a lot in government is we've put a lot of funding and of encouragement behind apprenticeships, because we really believe in apprenticeships.
I think you'll find that virtually all of the parties seem to agree to believe in apprenticeships. Steve, are you suggesting that the Liberal Democrats' policy is that university fees should be abolished?
That's still our aspiration as a party. Yeah. And I know why the laughter's there. So let's tackle this head on, if you like. So 5 years ago, I signed a pledge that I wouldn't vote for an increase in tuition fees. And if I'd have been elected 5 years ago, I would have been a government rebel, because I wouldn't have gone back on a pledge that I made to you. But whatever party wins this election, and whoever has to make the decision on how we're going to fund universities for the next 5 years, is going to have to tackle the question of how are we going to pay for it. And the only thing that we've managed to achieve in the coalition, which we did achieve, is a lot of measures that we insisted upon to make it easier to pay back. So now you don't have to pay anything back until you're earning 21,000. There's a cap on how much you pay back. It gets written off after 35 years, so on. So we try to make it as fair as possible. But I can't promise you, I don't think any party could promise you we could abolish tuition fees after the next election, because it's too far from here to there. We're already at a place where nearly 50% of us want to go to university, and we've got no money to pay for it. I would aspire to that, but I don't believe it would be sensible to promise you that in the next 5 years, because it's not going to happen.
The Liberal Democrats became a party of government, and they learned a really important lesson. You can promise anything if you don't think you've got to go and vote for it. If you haven't got to govern, you can promise things if you don't think you're going to govern. They promised in our EU referendum, they promised the stuff on tuition fees, they backed away from an in-out referendum, they backed away from tuition fees. I don't doubt Steve's absolutely sincere in what he has said. I don't doubt Steve's good intentions, honesty and integrity. He's a good man, he means it. But in government, it wasn't possible.
So how do you explain, Steve, the broken promises of the Conservatives? You promised that you wouldn't raise VAT, and then you raised it. You promised that there would be no top-down reorganisation of the NHS, but then there was a £3 billion top-down reorganisation of the NHS. What about those broken promises? Because I thought you expected to get into government then.
Yeah. There are three big taxes. They're VAT, national insurance and income tax. And the country was in a terrible mess, and the least damaging one to raise was VAT. I hated the fact. I hated that it had to go up.
Presumably knew before the election that he might have to do something to balance the books. So why did he say we've no plans to raise VAT?
If it's ever up to me, the way the thing will work differently at the top.
I'm going to go back to Taj. You asked a question. What's your view about fees?
I actually agree with the Conservative idea that it should stay at £9,000. I don't understand how universities would be able to afford it, and the government would be able to afford it if we... For example, the Green Party and the UK Party said that they would abolish it. How would you pay for that?
Well, for a start, if you're not giving so much money away, then you've got more to spend at home, haven't you? We've said that we would abolish it for sciences, medicine, maths and engineers, skills that are vital for the future of this country, subject to, of course, academic performance, and also that if you've benefited, you then have to stay in the country, work and pay your taxes for 5 years afterwards. That, to me, seems to be a pretty fair policy. I mean, the country did afford it once. If it can have afforded it once, why can't it afford it now in the same way that it did before? I believe it can do. Where there's a will, there's a way.
Are you merely just a pressure group that's not accountable for their actions? So I don't see how that's possible.
No, you will see a fully costed manifesto which will be published in due course.
well, wait and see what it says about university fees there. I think it would be regrettable if we go back to a situation which I remember when I went to university all those decades ago, was that less than 10% of 18-year-olds went to university at that time, and I wouldn't want us to return to university education, which was elitist as it was then. I was privileged and benefited from it, but we shouldn't return to those days.
The social didn't drive Rolls-Royces, did they? I mean, Steve Baker made that point about how well the sort of administration and the the officers at universities have benefited from the £9,000 tuition fees. And Jem Bailey also said it's the workers haven't got anything out of it, it's people like you.
You
want it.
My salary when I was in the job was published and was public knowledge. You can check it out. It's not the way you think it is. Right, I'm going to move us on to the the next... onto
well, this is what happens. This is possibly one of the dim outs that have resulted from Labour's energy policies.
Can you all still in the audience still hear us? Yes. Okay. So I'm going to go on to the fourth question from Connor Arnott.
Following on from comments made by Nigel Farage a few weeks ago in regards to race discrimination laws in the workplace and immigration levels, should employers prioritise the hiring of British workers over foreign workers?
I think David Meacock, that's...
I think employers should have the opportunity to choose who they like to and who they want and should maybe able to make that choice on the basis that they choose. I mean, are you aware, for example, that because of EU legislation, that your council, when it went out to tender for the joint waste contact, Wycombe District Council, and which is actually run with Chiltern District Council, council taxpayers' money was wasted advertising this contract all over Europe when there would be plenty of tenderers available within the UK. Now, it seems to have gone to the other extreme. I don't see what Nigel said really as being any different from, by British. With regard to the race laws that you mentioned, I actually was with Nigel on his recent visit to Aylesbury, and he said that he'd listened back to the transcripts of that because he couldn't understand what all the furore was about. And what he'd said was that he thinks that in the heat of the moment, he'd answered a different question from what was being asked. So, well, you laugh,
Nigel,
but if any of you have actually been on stage in front of millions of people, perhaps you'd understand what the pressures are like. As a professional performing musician, I perhaps have some idea of that. But what I would say to you is that what he said I mean, how many of us as students have got an answer wrong because we actually haven't answered the question that we've been asked in exam papers? Now, to what he said was, and anybody's entitled to correct themselves and clarify themselves, what he said to us all, and in fact he told the national media, was that he thought Trevor Phillips' question was talking about the selection of people to do jobs and be candidates in UKIP. And that's why he said, you know, UKIP, we're colourblind. And that's really what he was the question that he was answering. And okay, it wasn't the question that he was asked. But at the end of the day, we've moved on as a country. I think we are more or less colourblind. And I think that these things should be enforced with a light touch. And I, for one, would certainly be happy if things moved that way and then suddenly we saw discrimination happening again. I'd certainly be happy then for the law to be tightened up a bit more to stop it reverting. But I think we've got to have laws which give employers freedom to actually run their businesses.
Steve Guy. Yeah,
thank you. I'm not even going to bother with what Nigel Farage said. I just want to pull you up on what you said. Because you said employers should be able to employ whoever they like. Correct? That's what you just said.
Yeah, why not?
Oh. I'll just invite the students to go and take a little history lesson and go and have a look at something called the Bristol bus boycott. So after the Second World War, we encouraged people from the Commonwealth to come and live in the UK. London Transport, for example, actively recruited bus drivers from the West Indies. But in Bristol, it was a different story because the management of the Bristol Omnibus Company said, we employ who we like. And they had a policy of not employing black bus drivers. And you can go away and look it up after tonight. But that was their policy. There's no law that says we have to employ bus drivers based on whether they're qualified or whether they're suitable. We can employ who we like. Well, and that was one of the catalysts. That was one of the...
What I would say is that employers should be able to choose on the basis of one of the catalysts
that led to us having a race relations law and race discrimination in employment laws were brought in partly as a result of the good people of Bristol decided to boycott the buses until the bus company changed its policy. And it worked. What David has just said is, well, let's now abandon that law and then see if it just works out. And then if not, we'll bring it back.
I've not advocated a return to that sort of thing. When I say I think employers should be able to employ who they like, what I'm meaning by that is that I think that they should be able to choose according to ability, and I, for one, would not be wanting racial discrimination, certainly in the way that you've described, at all.
But that wasn't what you said, Dan.
And I think we should be able to employ workers who are already living here, rather than adding to the horrendous levels of immigration that we've got, causing all sorts of pressures on the local services that we value so much.
I think there might be a problem with another exam question here. Does anybody else want to come?
Yeah, if I may, I'll make just three very quick points. The Equality Act was one of the first things that we voted through in the new Parliament. There is quite often consensus in politics. People do need protecting from bigotry, fear and hatred. They just do. I'm afraid this is a fallen and sinful world, and there are people out there with unreasoning hatreds within them, and we must protect everybody. Employers should, within the law, hire the best person for the job. That's the way it should be. It should be meritocracy, but they must comply with the law.
Absolutely.
And that law is the Equality Act in particular. The third point is this: what is this really all about? It's a conversation in the end about immigration, and it's a very sensitive subject. But there's two things, so often in matters related to the EU. Are we able to have an immigration policy, and what should that immigration policy be? Well, the truth is at the moment, in relation to other citizens of the EU, we can't have an immigration policy about other citizens of the EU. They've got free movement. And then what should that policy be? Well, I would like us to have an immigration policy which applies equally to everyone in the world. Because there's a particular issue here in Wycombe where if a grandmother wants to come and see her newborn grandchild from Pakistan, as I've just discovered, you can have the inhumanity of her being repeatedly denied access despite the guarantees of her son-in-law who's easily able to provide them. And it is an inhumanity, but there's all sorts to say about this, but we should be treating people equally. We're ending up with all sorts of tensions in all sorts of different directions because we're not. So I would like us to be able to have our own migration policy. That's the first thing. And then the second thing is to have a reasonable conversation about what it should be in order to make sure that our country flourishes in the fullest sense.
I think
think, I mean, it's my working, sorry. I think where you've got to look at it, I mean, migration is a fact of life. It's always happened. It's always been there from thousands of years. You know, our language, our culture, sort of the way of life has been enriched over that time. There is a myth that immigrants come over here and take our jobs. Immigrants spend their wages like you and me. In fact, in turn, they actually create jobs as well. EU immigrants have spent 20 billion more in taxes than they actually take away from benefits on the long run. I think Steve's very right. You have to be very, very careful on who you can reject and who you don't. I mean, a lot of people come here as refugees from war, from political repression, and stuff like that. So, I mean, you can't really reject those sort of people coming over, I think. That's pretty it, really.
Okay. David. I
think Connor's question had two components. The first part in relation to backtracking on the very hard-won equality rights that we now have. Absolutely not. They've been hard fought for. Anybody who knows anybody who suffered from discrimination, whether it's based on race or sex or sexuality, will know how corrosive it is to that individual, and we have to maintain the legal framework that we have to prevent discrimination. In terms of prioritising the hiring of British workers over foreign workers, it's got to be on merit, hasn't it? I mean, I've just come from Wycombe Hospital earlier on this evening, and amongst the nursing staff just treating my mum down there. A Spanish guy, a Lithuanian nurse, an Italian nurse, hired because they have the skills which are needed, because presumably there's a skills deficit in terms of nursing there. And so you hire people because of the skills that they have. Across the European Union, we have freedom of movement of individuals, and so if the person who's best qualified for the job is a Spanish nurse, of course you're going to hire them rather than a British person. You know, it's just another example of the lack of sense in UKIP and this ridiculous explanation that is trotted out time and time and time again by Nigel Farage. Oh, I misunderstood the question. Oh, you didn't hear me right. Just rewriting history time and time again because you can't trust him, even him. It's very difficult to trust him when he opens his mouth.
We've got a few minutes before I move on to the next question. Does anybody from the audience want to make a comment in connection with what we've just been hearing? About two-thirds down towards on the that's it. Thank you.
Steve,
can you say who? Can say who you are?
I'm
please?
Jack. Steve Baker. He mentioned hatred. I'd like to go to David Meacock and his reason for leaving the Conservative Party over his views on same-sex marriage.
Well, that's a whole subject in itself, which I don't think was part of this question. And I think those sorts of questions are usually traditionally thought of as personal conviction ones. And I'm very happy to defend my views, but I don't think that's the topic that we're on right now.
Just been asked.
Well, we're happy to debate it, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I'm. Well, if people would like me to debate it, then I'm very happy to do so. I believe that marriage should be between one female and one male. Marriage isn't just about two people who love each other living together. Marriage, if you read the church words in the service, the church liturgy in the service, there are certain actual paragraphs that actually are legally required. And a big part of marriage is actually the procreation of children. Now, put religion aside for a minute. In order to procreate a child, you need one female and one male. And I think that's not just designed for procreation. It's designed because that child needs the difference between a mother and a father. And I say that as a father of a boy and a girl. And those of you who are parents will know that for completely irrational reasons, sometimes they want to go and talk to mummy, sometimes they want to go and talk to daddy. Well, if you have gay marriage and specifically create children to go into that situation, you're immediately denying that child that opportunity because they've only got two males or two females. So in this, I put the children first and their welfare before the desires of adults.
What about children who, where one of their parents has died and they only have a mother or a father to go to, or where their parents have separated?
Yeah, I'm quite happy to talk about this from the church's perspective, because I'm an Anglican. And one of the ways in which Christianity, in fact other religions too, but one of the ways in which the Christian church has gone wrong over decades and centuries is that it thinks its place is to tell other people how to live their lives. Now, I'm not gay, so I don't know what it's like to be gay. But you know what? If you are, and your partner is, and you feel that you want to make a commitment to each other of the marriage vows and all of that entails, who am I to stop you? It's not my place to judge what's right for you. So that's why I support gay marriage. I think it's not for me to...
Steve Baker.
The most profoundly draining and emotional issue, the most profoundly conflicted issue of this Parliament, and I include war and peace votes, was gay marriage. And the debate was going on last time I was on this platform. What I found was that there's a really profound intergenerational split. People of about my parents' age and older tend to be deeply against. People about my age and younger tend to be equally convicted that we should allow gay marriage. Personally, I think that people should be able to get married as same-sex couples. But I found myself faced with this profound dissonance of agreement. Now, I think actually it's no business of government who calls themselves married. The sexual and loving relations of consenting adults really are not for me to impose on anybody. So I set out what I thought should be done, which was basically the denationalisation of marriage. I said that there should be a single, equal state relationship, that like France or South Africa do it, a civil union, and then marriage should be built on top. And that way the Roman Catholics could say no, because forgive me if any Roman Catholics here are in favour of gay marriage, but overwhelmingly the correspondence showed that they were not, whereas the Quakers, for example, overwhelmingly were in favour. But let them go on. But we've ended up in a position now where the Church of England, the Archbishop of Canterbury told me, is still trying to solve this problem. So I voted against second reading because I thought it was the wrong way to do it. But if you look at the balance of my votes in the end on theyworkforyou.com, you'll find that it says that I'm for. So I thought that we went about it the wrong way. I actually thought we should go about it a more liberal way than in fact we actually did. And that if we'd allowed people to have civil unions with marriage built on top, then we would have had a lot less conflict, a lot more tolerance, and actually a lot easier time.
But so do you now support gay marriage, Steve?
I've just stated plainly what my view is. I think it should be done through a single secular relationship which is indifferent to people's gender.
Yeah, that's not the situation we have at the moment. Do you support gay marriage under the legal framework we currently have?
My votes are a matter of public record.
Yes or no, Steve?
Go and look at my votes.
Yes or no?
You can't do that because the EU...
I'm going to ask Jem, and then what we're going to do is then we're going to be going into the final question, because I think that'll round off this evening's event. Jem?
Just a very quick answer, Rhys. I mean, I think most people know how the Green Party stands on homosexuality and gay marriage, etc. I don't think you can deny anyone the right to have a relationship, and I don't think you can deny a couple to have a loving child. End of story, really.
Right, what I'm going to do now is ask Cam Clott to ask our last question this evening. And I think this will give an opportunity, and I'm going to ask all of the panel members to be brief in their responses, because I think this will then provide, as I say, a summary of what we've been talking about this evening. Cam.
Can businesses have any confidence in the UK economy over the next 12 months? And how does the UK expect to maintain itself as a major player in the financial services industry with the bonus cap existing, and if a Labour government comes into power, a potential bonus tax?
I think the fundamental question here is around the confidence that we might have in the UK economy over the next 12 months.
It's a matter for the public to decide. You know, here we are, it's a general election. I can assure you, when your name's on the ballot paper, you do not take it for granted. It is up to you who governs this country. And if it's David Cameron, the trajectory that we're on will continue, and it will be stable, and it will be reliable, and it will be supportive of business with lower taxes on business, lower taxes on jobs, with low interest rates, and with the confidence that comes from political stability. But you can all read the newspapers as well as I can, and I'm not going to try and put some trite lines before you, but you know what is going on in Scotland. You know that there are people are getting frustrated and voting for minority parties. All sorts of things could happen. What I am certain of is if that we put David Cameron back in number 10 as Prime Minister, that we will have stability and business will flourish. We will have more jobs, we will be more prosperous, and we'll go on and we'll be successful. If something else happens, well, actually, we could be back here towards the end of the year, having had an unstable government collapse, and we could be back here for another general election. I would like us to have a stable government. I would like it to be a Conservative government, and I would like it to give us, well, the things that you're looking for, stability and business going forwards.
Jen.
The answer is really depends on who wins the election at the end of the day. If you want to continue with the rich-poor divide and enlarge that sort of divide, then you know, it's continue as we are. Yes, businesses might be flourishing, but where is it flourishing? It's flourishing in the financial sector, and the sector benefits only a small minority. I think the way forward is actually investing more local and self-promoting companies and smaller firms and sort of that sort of side of the business, and back to the engineering sort of side of the business that has had this company in good stead along the way.
Thank
you. Well, recently retired EU Justice Commissioner Vivian Reding said that all member states have 75% of their laws sprouting from Brussels, to use my own pun to summarise what she said. So your choice really is between any of the three legacy parties, between which you couldn't get a cigarette paper because they're kowtowing to that framework, and actually getting your country back and allowing yourselves to decide what you want done with a party that will come out of the EU, and then we'll have true democracy back again, and then we can actually have a proper debate as to what we tax and what we spend. That's your choice at the next on May the 7th.
David Williams.
Well, that neatly dovetails with one of the main points which I think affects confidence in the UK economy, which is the EU question and the European Union referendum, because business leaders say that one of the biggest breaks on investment is the uncertainty over what our position is going to be within the European Union, because, you know, make no bones about it, the European Union is absolutely essential to our economy. Hundreds of thousands of jobs, billions of pounds of trade, 44% of our trade is done with Europe, and almost every chief executive of every major UK company says we've got to stay in it, we can't leave it, and we need to commit to it, not this idea of a referendum which puts a brake on investment. So that's point one. The second point is, the world suffered a major recession as a result of the banking crisis. Every major economy suffered a recession, and every country has to make choices about how it seeks to deal with that. And the Conservatives and the Liberal Democrats have made their choices. We would make different choices. One of the critical problems with our economy at the moment compared with other developed economies is productivity. And one of the issues with that is because so many of our jobs are 0 hours contracts, so many of them are low paid, that our productivity levels are lower. What we say in the Labour Party is that if we get productivity levels up through investment in young people, apprenticeships, a living wage, then our productivity will improve, taxes rise, more money comes into the exchequer, that helps to improve the economy. We support small businesses. We have a small business administration. We have a British investment bank. So we support businesses to invest their way out of this recession, to get people into work. And in due course, we will balance the books by the end of the next parliament, and the economy will be back on track. But the choices will be fairly made. We will look to make tax rises where necessary. And we've already set all of those out, all of our spending commitments are costed, and the source of the revenue is identified, and we will invest those in ensuring that the economy recovers, that business recovers, that young people and others who want to work can work for a proper living wage.
And Steve Guy.
It's an interesting question for me as a Liberal Democrat, because in the 2010 election, both Labour and the Conservatives spent quite a bit of time and effort putting across the message that if one of them didn't win an overall majority, this country was going to be in terrible trouble because it wouldn't have a stable government. And I think what we've successfully done over the last 10 years, since 2010 rather, is prove that we are actually a serious party, a party that you can trust, and that, true to our word, we will work together with whoever it is necessary to work with to form stable government, because that's what the country needs. And I also...
Did the Democrat voters from the biz for a blank piece of paper, in other words?
Not at all. But a UKIP vote is for a vote for someone that's trotting out the same lies they trotted out in 2010. And you're all internet savvy, so you can go on the Channel 4 fact check on their website. In 2010, Farage was trotting out this line about 70% of our laws being made in Brussels. It's a myth, OK? Go away and have a look for yourselves. Don't take my word for it.
It's not 7%, that's for sure.
65.
Well, even that,
55
I think...
is closer to 75 than it is to 7.
Well, OK, I work for a Swedish company. I'm based in the UK. We employ 250 engineers in the UK. Do you want to put my job at risk? Does my job not matter?
If we left the EU, would you stop drinking French wine or buying German cars? No way. They sell more to us than we sell to them, which is why if we leave the EU, we can then trade with the world and not be denied our seat at the World Trade Organization.
I'm going to let everybody have a couple of words each, okay? David.
On the economy, the Japanese embassy...
And I encourage a couple of words in this...
If we're talking about Europe, the Japanese embassy itself says 130,000 jobs in Britain with Japanese companies are reliant on our membership of the European Union.
Steve Baker.
We need peace, free trade, rule of law amongst nation states in the nations of Europe. We need trade, uninhibited trade, but we need trade with the whole world, not just with Europe, with the whole world. And we're in a customs union, and that means we can't make trade deals with the whole world. We need to make trade deals with the whole world. And on this point about companies, asking companies, well, which companies? If you ask very large companies, they'll tell you you need to stay in the EU. They like big government, they like big regulations, because then their lobbyists can try and capture it. But if you ask small businesses, who, by the way, are our future, because that's where the growth, by definition, is bound to come from, then quite often they'll tell you they want out. What we need, though, is a referendum, because it's actually extremely bad manners to assemble a country without asking permission. There's all sorts of things I care about, all sorts of things, but that was the one thing that triggered me getting into politics. I won the argument in this parliament that we should have a referendum, and I'm jolly well going to see it through.
Jen.
Yeah. I think if you look at the EU as a whole, it has been progressive. I mean, it safeguards our human rights, peace and security. It gives you environmental protection. It's a spread of culture. It's regulation, really, of the financial system. So, in the end of the day, we really support more of a local self-reliance thing and not really the unsustainable action of sort of free trade and growth.
Okay.
Well, big European companies employ a lot of people in the UK. To pull out of the EU, it would be to take an enormous gamble. I'm not willing to recommend that gamble to the British people.
I'm now, with that, going to suggest that we've now had a very good evening of debate and discussion. I think it's your questions have prompted some... what adjective can I use? But anyway, some interesting responses from up here. And interesting is an interesting word, isn't it? Thank you all very much for being here. On your behalf, I'd like to thank all of our 5 parliamentary candidates, the panel members, for being with us this evening. And I hope that you all have a good journey home. So thank you all very much for being here.